Dear ladies and gentlemen, we move on now to our third and final technology pitch of this workshop, and it also focuses on the liquid hydrogen pathway with a novel approach to refueling based on cryogas. We promised you earlier we'd take a deeper dive on this, and that time has now come. The fast-moving German startup Cryomotive is developing this new cryogenic liquid hydrogen storage technology for commercial applications and that have high energy storage requirements. We will hear first from Cryomotive founder, Dr. Tobias Brunner, who formerly headed BMW's technology project Hydrogen Fuel Cell. And then picking up directly after that is Cryomotive CTO, Christian Forstner. And once again, ladies and gentlemen, we welcome your questions, and then I will put them to the two speakers after their dual presentation. And if your question is intended for one or the other of these two gentlemen, please feel free to let me know that. So Tobias Brunner, the floor is yours.
Thank you for the introduction. Yes, good evening to Europe, good morning to the United States and North America. We are Cryomotive, located in the Munich metropolitan area. The company is young, but the technology that I would talk about is not as young. So the cryocompressed hydrogen storage and refueling technology has first been mentioned 20 years ago in the United States, and it has been developed by BMW to a TRL 7 level between 2007 and 2012. We as Cryomotive have taken over that technology and will now develop it for commercial vehicles and other applications, as we will show you today. Next slide, please. So we're talking about cryogas, cryocompressed hydrogen gas refueling, and its technology opportunities, challenges, the roadmap that we have in mind and the standardization needs. Next slide, please. So what is cryogas, cryocompressed hydrogen gas? The focus is on gas. We're not talking about a liquid. We definitely are far above the critical point in terms of temperature as well as in terms of pressure. So we're talking about a gas. But it's a cold gas, a very cold gas, a compressed gaseous hydrogen up to 35 MPa at cryogenic temperature. The range that we will run the storage in regularly is in between 30 Kelvin and 200 Kelvin. And there will be an extended range where we can go up to ambient temperatures. And that would be something like in special cases only. Cryogas is generated by cryocompression of liquid hydrogen or by cryocooling of gaseous hydrogen. So there are two ways to generate a cryogas. Cryogas from liquid hydrogen is denser than liquid hydrogen. That has been proven. There are pumps out there that could do it, and that's not the limit. So 80 grams per liter and more are doable at the pump. It is furthermore a vehicle fuel for onboard storage with very good heat receptivity and strong self-cooling capability, as I will show you later. And it is a fuel for quick single flow refueling with no need for a communication between station and vehicle. Next slide. So first of all, I want to give you a thermodynamic classification and want to point out the operating range that we have in mind for commercial vehicle application. What you see here is a density over temperature diagram, you see the liquid hydrogen area to your left. That's the blue lines and the blue area. You see the two-phase area, the saturation line, the gaseous, as well as the liquid one. Then you see the compressed gaseous hydrogen area to your right, above minus 40 degrees Celsius, going up to 85. That's the normal operating range of gaseous compressed hydrogen storage. In between, there is a region that has not been used so far, other than by cryocompressed hydrogen. That is what we call the cryogas. And so it's anything below a certain temperature and everything above the critical temperature, which is 33 Kelvin. If you give me another click, I could show you where the operating range of a cryogas storage would be. So we basically think that 35 MPa is a good upper pressure level. We don't need any more. We believe that it makes some sense to stay supercritical. So we are only going below the 1.5 MPA in cases where we want to really use the maximum capacity out of the storage. If you give me another click, then I can show you how we produce the cryogas. So we compress liquid hydrogen and that increases its density. It has been proven more than 10 years ago. And there are multiple pumps out there here in Munich area that do the same. They use it for gaseous compressed dispensing in the end, but in reality, you compress liquid hydrogen to pressure level up to 80 grams per liter or higher. If you then fill this kind of gas into an insulated pressure vessel, then you end up with something above 70 grams per liter if your tank is in regular cold operation. And then you start using it. And if you give me another click, then I can show you what that means in terms of truck operating range. Would you please click? That is the a regular operating range of a cryogas truck tank. So we are not getting into the warmer temperature regions as we believe. We have huge vessels. These vessels will be regularly used. So basically we expect that we will not exceed 120 Kelvin in any regular operation. And that will help us in many senses in terms of vacuum stability, in terms of durability and more. I will give details in the presentation later. Next slide. So what are the opportunities of cryogas onboard storage? Many people ask the question, why should I combine cryogenic temperatures and pressure? The answer is because there are evident multiple advantages. First of all, and there is a very high physical and system storage density. We can be 40% higher density volumetrically than compressed gaseous 70 MPa hydrogen in typical truck packages, and we are significantly lighter than any battery could be. We would also be lighter than any high-pressure gaseous storage at 35 MPa or 70 MPa. That is an advantage too in a truck, and we have a very flexible package integration option. We can actually package in multi-vessel configurations. And one more important advantage is we believe we can adapt the pressure to supply power, to power any fuel cell hydrogen internal combustion engine. I agree to Dr. Mao's statement that basically a fuel cell doesn't need too much pressure, but the fuel cell systems that we have on the market now, they usually are in a range of 10 to 15 bars, so 1.0 to 1.5 megapascal. That is the entire fuel cell systems. You would need to adapt those to a much lower pressure range for liquid hydrogen onboard storage. Also for internal combustion engines, turbocharged, if they come with hydrogen, there are still some activities ongoing. They may need up to 5 MPa, at least 3 MPa. That for sure can easily be supplied by a cryocompressed hydrogen storage, and it would be more challenging for liquid. We can also offer a very robust thermal behavior that allows simplified mass-producible insulation because we can accept much more heat than a liquid hydrogen storage could adopt. And there is a cost-effective design option. So we have a moderate material manufacturing cost, as I will point out later. Next slide, please. So here you see a typical truck package that we are working on currently. So we can combine different integration options. We can for sure use frame integrated vessels to the left and the right, such as we've seen before, but we can also add other vessels behind the cabin. So overall, we have options to vary the storage capacity per vessel between 10 and 100 kilograms. In a truck environment, usually that's not exceeding 50 kilograms per vessel, but there are other applications where it may be interesting to go higher. The storage system gravimetric density in a typical truck configuration would be 8 to 10 weight percent. Volumetrically, we can achieve 1.2 to 1.5 kilowatt hours per liter system volume. And one big advantage is that we can actually accept 20 to 50 watt heat leak in such a system and can still be loss free. The minimum holding time, and that's at higher heat leak of 30 watts, is 1 to 2 days. According to the installation design, the average holding time at 50% capacity would be in between 10 and 30 days. So there for sure, there will never be any challenge in the truck sector. Next slide, please. So here you see a few typical package configurations. The first one is a two-vessel package alongside the frame left and right that we have similarly seen in the presentation before. It could store up to 78 kilograms of cryocompressed hydrogen in the configuration that we have in mind. We are not maximizing the vessel in the same way as, for example, Daimler does, so our vessels are a little smaller, because they fit into multiple truck environments, and they should. We have a three-vessel package with a second tank dimension that we can add to the two tanks left and right. That would give us up to 105 kilograms capacity. And we could also make a four-vessel package behind the cabin that would allow us to store up to 115 kilograms of cryocompressed hydrogen gas. We are able to vary these with just two tank dimensions, and that's what we plan to do in the next 3 years, develop maximum two vessel geometries, and these we can combine to all these packages that you see here. Next slide. So I'd like to point out a little how a cryogas storage works. So in refueling, you go up from the lower pressure, which usually is 1.5 megapascal. And if you then would park the vehicle, the pressure would be rising into an area up to 35 megapascal. You can absorb quite a bit of heat there. And then when you drive, you can actually decrease the pressure again down to the minimum working pressure. For example, that could be a 1.5 megapascal. And then we have an internal heat exchanger mechanism that can keep this pressure as long as needed until the vessel is empty. We could also set different pressures like 0.6 MPa, or we can just use the area from 1.5 to lower as a reserve. Even a fuel cell that usually needs 1.5 megapascal at the regulator could still work with lower pressure at lower power in a reserve mode. So the usable storage densities that we can offer for different powertrain options are, for example, 66 grams per liter in a real storage environment for a fuel cell powertrain with 1.5 megapascal pressure demand. For one with 0.6 megapascal, it could be 2 grams per liter higher. And if we need to supply to a hydrogen internal combustion engine, at 5 megapascal, then we could still offer a 58 gram per liter usable density. Next slide, please. So now let's come to one big difference to liquid hydrogen onboard storage. That is holding time and losses. For a truck system with the dimensions of truck storage vessels, we are not foreseeing any situation where we can really come into troublesome loss situations. So the first distribution that you see here in green is the one for the cryogas vessel, and the blue ones represent liquid hydrogen and storage systems at lower pressures. We depict that for two different pressure ranges. The larger blue ones are for 0.6 to 2 megapascal. If you give me a click, then I show you what this heat receptivity, which is purely thermodynamic and physical, given dimensionless in watt hours per liter, a net hydrogen volume would result into dormancy times before vent, so vent-free holding times. As you can see here, for a liquid hydrogen storage system, with 600 liters net volume, if it is fully filled at 65 grams per liter, you would easily calculate the heat receptivity to 39.2 watt hours. If you then have an average heat flux to the system of 30 watts, then you would result into 1.3 hours holding time before vent. If you have an insulation that allows you to go to 5 watts, that would be 7.8 hours. If you have insulations that go better than that 5 watts, then you could for sure reach 10 hours or more. Another click, please. Now the same situation for a cryogas tank. So basically here we have a higher density. We can start with 72 grams per liter. And then you can already see at the height of the bars that we obviously also have a higher heat transductivity. So if we start with 72 grams per liter and we have a 600 liter net fuel volume, and we let the fully filled vessel be in dormant, up to 35 MPa, then we have a heat receptivity of 103 watt hours. And if again, you divide that by 30 to 5 watts, according to the insulation that you have, you would result into 16.8 hours to 101 hours. So we are very free to design an insulation and that fulfills the requirement. For sure, it's not a 5 watt insulation. That would not be necessary, and we want to use the opportunity of the high heat receptivity to simplify insulation. If you give me another click, we show you what happens with a half full tank, which you could say is the average. If you look at the liquid one, there you can see that the situation improves significantly in that density area. So if you go to 35 grams per liter, you could actually absorb a lot more heat here. And that would result into 29 hours for a 30-watt insulation, up to 170 hours for a 5-watt insulation. And if you go below, you could even reach higher dormancy times, which are certainly enough for any truck operation. If you look at the cryocompressed one, give me another click, please. Then you would see that, again, the dimension is a totally different one. If you have a cryogas storage at 1.5 MPa, with a vent pressure of 35 MPa, that would actually result in a heat transductivity of more than 8,000 watt hours. And if you divide that by 30 to 5 watts, you would have 11 days to 67 days of dormancy, of last free dormancy. So basically, that tells us that we can actually make a quite simple insulation in the range of 20 to 30 watts or even worse than that. The dimensioning situation, the dimension and case is certainly the fully filled tank, and then we need to design an insulation that's good enough for a truck operation, which we can do. So that's a huge advantage of the cryogas system. We will not see losses. We still are prepared for vent losses. It's not boil off because we are having a gas and not a two-phase hydrogen. We call it blow off in that case, but it will rarely happen. And if it happens, you can easily calculate that the blow off rates actually are much lower than they would be in a liquid hydrogen tank environment. Next slide, please. So that is when I want to hand over to Christian Fosner, our CTO, who would give you a few insights into the onboard storage challenges that we face with cryogas.
Thanks, Tobias. So I will catch up on the challenges. We heard about opportunities. It's basically boils down to the three points shown here. So first of all, it's the transfer of the storage design from passenger cars to the commercial vehicle applications. That's to some extent really different. So on the one hand, we use opportunities that we have continuous operation and large dimensions of the vessels. We can optimize, and we will optimize, the thermal design, as we just heard. We simplify that insulation, but also we can improve the cooling, the thermal management of the fuel cell system by providing cold energy. But we also have to design it for longer durability for a truck lifetime. Second, we will standardize our design to match with different applications, to be quite modular. And third, we right from the beginning have to focus and will focus on design to manufacturing and design to cost approaches strictly. Well, the next slide, please. Let's talk about the requirements in a truck environment. What will change? It's not about only scaling up. So having on the left-hand side the Hydrogen 7 BMW, that was the original system. smaller dimensions. Now we grow to 600 up to 700 and even more millimeters in diameter of the tank system of the one single storage, up to 2.6 meters length even. Still variable, but it has to fit into the truck package. Capacity-wise, we increase by more to the factor of 10 from 7 kilograms to 75 up to 115 kilograms of hydrogen storage. We will also change from a single vessel design to a multiple vessel package design, as we see on top, so different possibilities available there, being able to fuel them all at the same time. The operating temperature range changes significantly. Already heard, instead of having the range of minus 230 degrees C up to 85 plus, we have now restricted a smaller range of minus 230 up to minus 150, so it's a span of maximum 80 Kelvin. That keeps also the hydrocarbons in the winding in the carbon fiber, and there is no basically no outgassing, destroying a vacuum, so overcoming this issue, which also leads to a high durability demand, so at least or close to six times the lifetime, four times the refueling cycles, up to 2,000 to cover the entire truck lifetime. Refueling itself has to speed up, definitely, so we are not restricted by the tank system. It's just about pump capacities. We can and we intend to go up to 10 kilograms per minute to be able to refuel a range of 1,000 kilometers in less than 10 minutes, so coming close to diesel parity at this point. Next slide, please. I was talking about modular design. So in this chart, I'll compare different applications with respect to volumetric density of the entire storage system. So it covers all the components, volumetric density as well as gravimetric density. And you see cryocompressed, that's the green bar, it's hard to beat in almost all applications except maybe aviation, if we have a full aluminum liquid hydrogen tank, or also in mining trucks, which comes with huge volumes of liquid hydrogen. In all other applications, we see a clear advantage, even in garbage trucks on the right-hand side, because there's really limited packaging space. Next slide, please. Now we come to our cost roadmap. We already heard from LBST, from Mr. Zerhuizen, that at the pump, it's very likely that liquid hydrogen cryocompressed come at lower cost compared to 70 megapascal gaseous hydrogen. But we also see huge cost advantages in our storage system for trucks. So that's why we today want to present even a first cost assumption for different annual quantities of systems. So the y-axis shows the euros per kilogram hydrogen stored. And it's also clearly visible that we are not material cost driven, rather process cost driven, because when it comes to high quantities like 100,000 units per year, you see the amount of cost for the cryogenic pressure vessel for our core component becomes very low. And this is due to the fact that, for instance, in compared to 70 megapascal high pressure storage, we just use 1/5 of carbon fiber. We also use a lower design pressure. It's only a maximum of 350 bars, 35 megapascal. And that also leads to a low consumption of carbon fiber. So at the end, we are really cost effective. Still, we will drive that down to even more reasonable figures in the future, and we will also team up with partners to bring that even more down in future. Well, that's the point where I'd like to hand over to Tobias Brunner again. Next slide, please.
Point. Thank you, Christian. So now I'd like to go to the refueling. This session was about refueling, but we were expecting that there is a lot of lack of understanding of the cryogas storage technology, so we started with that. So there is opportunities in cryogas refueling as well, because we are very flexible. We can basically start from liquid hydrogen base stations as well as from gaseous based stations. We can cryocompress liquid hydrogen to the densities that we have shown, but we can also cryocool gaseous hydrogen down to a temperature where we triple the density of gaseous hydrogen and then store this cryogenic gas into a cryogas vessel. So that is one of the evident opportunities of the technology. And the second one is we have synergies with an existing 35 MPa infrastructure, because we could combine a cryo cooler into it and would allow a combined 35 MPa gaseous as well as cryo gas infrastructure. Give me the next slide, please. So that's what depicts our plan. We want to develop two types of stations. The one comes with liquid hydrogen as a basis, and it uses cryo pumps and some intermediate buffers and boosters. I can't disclose any details here, but that's a very interesting concept that actually is modular enough to ramp up with the scale. In the beginning, we expect that the number of trucks is still low, so a fully scaled liquid hydrogen station with multiple pumps would probably produce significant losses. We could avoid that by using a booster concept. And on the other hand, we could use existing 35 MPa stations and add the cryocooler. That definitely costs some energy. I fully agree with that. And it will add cost to the refueling, but it could use an existing infrastructure and maybe keep cost reasonable. At least it's a very interesting bridging technology for the time where we still wait for the large liquefies that will certainly come. Next slide. So I now give you an insight into these three station concepts that we see as the major pathways for us. The first is the pure liquid hydrogen-based cryogas station that would have a supply of 7,000 to 8,000 kilograms a day. And we would have a buffer and booster system in between that allows us to intermediately store 400 to 2,000 kilograms. And the pump itself with the booster could basically do 200 to 800 kilograms per hour at 30 MPa. And that we would like to fill via a nozzle system that I will give you a few more details later with a fill rate of 200 to 250 grams per second at 30 MPa in a temperature range of 35 to 50 Kelvin. Next. So now you can combine that station type with 35 MPa dispensing. So you could add buffers such as we see them today at 35 up to 50 MPa to do a back-to-back refueling to H35 storage systems. And that could well be supplied by the cryocompression system and the liquid hydrogen base. Next. And then there is the gaseous-based supply system, either via trailers in the early phase and later a direct pipeline connection, if it really makes sense. And then this station, which is a purely gaseous one, could then have so-called cryocooler unit that would cool down to cryogenic temperatures and triple the density of the 35 MPa hydrogen, and that we could fill into our insulated pressure vessel. And that would enable a certain flexibility in the coming 10 years to use multiple stations that are available and also develop new stations that then are optimized for liquid hydrogen supply. Next, please. So we are not starting from zero. There has been done a lot of work. There has been developed a nozzle, a cryogas nozzle in the past, a cryogas receptacle. There are dispensers that have been tested, and we would reference to that, but develop an upgrade of such a system. We still believe that the energy consumption of such a station is quite good. We expect 0.25 to 0.5 kilowatt hours per kilogram. That for sure is higher than if you stay at very low pressure liquid. We agree to that, but we would be assuming that this is a fully loss-free system since we are very robust in the sense that we fill a gas, so you would never have a returning gas into that station. The only thing you may need to do is drive before fill, but we will never be empty, but significantly full in such a situation as I've shown before. So whatever you do here, there would only be a single flow non-communication nozzle that we have developed, that we have tested jointly with Linde at the time. And it worked quite well. There's some room for improvement, and we definitely need to upsize to up to 800 kilograms per hour, 13 kilograms per minute, so something in between 200 and 250 grams per second. We believe that such a nozzle can be quite compact and handy because we have a combination of pressure and very high density from temperature. So in that sense, the combination is an advantage. We can make a compact and very robust refueling interface. Next, please. Coming close to an end, I tell you a little on the roadmap. So we are in phase one now and develop and validate a first truck storage system that will run in a truck 2023, in multiple trucks actually. We develop and validate a high flow nozzle between 200 and 250 grams per second. We are currently forming a consortium. So if you have interest, you're highly welcome to join us, and we are about to form a consortium to develop and validate two types of stations, one starting from liquid hydrogen supply and one starting from gaseous hydrogen supply. And for sure, we also are very interested to start the cryogas refueling interface standardization now. In phase two, between 2024 and 2025, we would deploy a first small series of truck storage systems and multiple stations. And we would also set up manufacturing JVs in key markets. And then in phase three, from 2025 plus onwards, that's about scale up of storage and station deployment. And hopefully we have a complete interface standard by then. Next slide. That's a quick view on what we have in mind as our roadmap. I mentioned most of it. So we are having a significant validation program in mind in the coming 2 to 3 years. So we will validate two full vessels, two geometries that we then combine to any kind of system. And we will actually prove 2,000 refueling cycles and more if needed. There is some opportunities since we are staying cold. This system is not varied in between cold and warm all the time. It will stay cryogenic. There's no reason why we should go up to ambient temperature. That is a big advantage in terms of fatigue of the materials. And also certainly we have a very continuous operation on that system, which we think will help us in that sense. On the standardization, we would like to be part of the white paper process and also give a first idea of a cryogas refueling system, interface system by the end of this year, which will then be followed by a nozzle development testing and the validation of the refueling interface, hoping that by the end of 2022, we could go into a standardization in ISO. Next. Just a few brief words, what we need to do in standardizing such a system. I don't want to go through all those points. We need to secure general compatibility with hydrogen, cryogenic temperatures, and combined low temperatures and pressure. We need to work on piping designs, loads, fixtures, supports. The refueling hose is a key development focus, design, loads, insulation, fatigue of that, nozzle and receptacle. We will dimension that, include purging, icing protection, leak tightness, protection, crest resistance, emergency shutdown, and so on. Pressure and relief devices, there is something we can reference to. It had been done before, but we for sure need to transfer that to the truck application. And there's a few other topics that you can read yourself down to the maintenance guidelines that for sure we need to work on before we can standardize the system. I want to conclude by just emphasizing once again that we are not starting from zero. This is not a concept. It has been proven in a vehicle environment. It has been crash tested in various environments. It has been winter tested and summer tested before. And now it is about to transfer into a truck environment. And that's what Cryomotive wants to do. And we will do it with partners. We have multiple partnerships that we communicate in the next 3 to 6 months. And we're looking forward to more partners joining us if there's interest. Thank you very much, and we're open for your questions.